This is Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Shaffer.
Hello, Jennifer.
Hello, Richard.
How are you?
I am great. I'm pretty happy. Besides taking a little tumble, so it's already happening. Yes.
You took a little tumble. Yeah, you did mention it limped on the air, which is what happened.
It's fine. I don't know what my thing
is. Were you distracted? Was spirit like waving things in front of your face and you?
I'm always distracted. That's the problem.
Okay. Well, people who
great news. Okay. I hit my knee, right? You know, I think it's kind of funny. I am very excited that my pants did not even look like I hit my, they are perfect. I scraped my knee underneath a little bit. I feel like I'm a teenager now that like was running and fell or whatever. And I'm fine. I'm like, okay, so then I don't have to get into any more accidents for the rest of the year. We're good.
The rest of the year. All right. That's pretty cool. It could be Mercury and retrograde. You know, they say that. I notice it when I'm out driving in traffic and suddenly, you know, people are cutting me off, stopping their car, ambulances flying by. I've had that a couple of times in the past week where I just went, oh my gosh, you know, 1 second earlier and that would have happened. So
just like Bruce Lipton, right?
Well, what's that?
How he heard a voice saying pull over.
Oh yeah. That's right. Bill Bennett
and Drury,
both of those and Gary Schwartz. I wasn't aware of
Gary Schwartz.
Yeah. So yeah, that idea that, you know, you just have to pay attention because things are coming at us all over the place.
All the time. And it only happens when you're in a hurry.
Isn't that funny?
Rarely happens when you're being mindful and you're watching what you're doing.
Yes, that's right. While you're in meditative equipoise, Rarely, unless you're driving while you're meditating. So speaking of driving and meditation, our friend Luana Andrews, who moderates our classroom on the flip side, who does the same thing Jennifer's doing, but from the other side of the veil. Lou, we're inviting you to come and talk.
Oh, well, she's already going, bum, 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 pick me, pick
her
me.
Hand up.
Really funny.
Please, Lou.
You don't want to talk about that. Oh, I did forget. She's reminding me that I forgot that after our last session, I was supposed to tell you something.
Oh.
And she's just reminding me again of what that is. So don't let me forget.
Okay. It's not something you can say on the air?
Nope.
Okay. Chalk that up. Don't forget to ask Luana about something. Oh, it's, you know, it's interesting because I must say there's a neighbor of mine, very generously, she does like channeling and, you know, reading and stuff like that. And she very generously, she had read one of my books and she said, you know, I had this session the other day where people were talking to me and they were telling me to tell you something. And so I want to ask Luana about that.
And she said, yeah.
She said, yeah, that was accurate what they were saying?
Not all of it.
Not all of it. Okay, Lou.
But the gist of it was accurate.
Okay. It was, they were trying to get me to be more in depth. And I don't know if the word was be more authentic, but I was trying to say an argument like, well, I'm just asking questions. How authentic do I have to be? But go ahead.
You're being authentic. Hold on. I think the whole idea is that we can be ourselves and do this work. And I think that's where it got mixed up in what she was giving you.
Okay. Be ourselves and do this work.
You don't have to sit there and meditate for 10 hours to get into that state to receive information. We just do it. We're used to it. I'm not saying there's anything wrong, but I think.
Well, you're especially used to it because, of course, they're talking to you all day long.
And it's actually more challenging not to talk to spirit while I'm in meditation. It's almost.
That's right. You were saying that last week that, you know, you've learned that you can meditate on yourself and think about things about yourself. Okay. So that was just a question. Lou, who do you want us to talk to today? Who do you want to bring forward so we can chat with? Who would that be?
Amelia.
Amelia Earhart. I'll take it. There's not that many other Amelias we know. But please.
It goes back to, and then I think she's just saying kind of what we were talking about. Hold on.
We were talking about Electra.
Oh,
Go
there's
ahead.
always going to be a series of like, they're showing me my last 2 months. I've had a lot, going on. It's happening around me, but it's been great as well. It's just that they're saying, from what I'm picking up on, and really it's just like, don't take everything so seriously. There's plenty of times where you have to be serious. Like, you should be able to escape. Spirit doesn't want us to be serious all the time. They want us to be ourselves. They want us to have fun. And you and I've all, we've always known that. Like, we've always, no one has ever said they wish they would have held back
Yeah,
from
that's right. People on the flip side, when they get home, nobody hears, "I wish I had done less."
Oh, and the other thing that I was, they're reminding me of is like, I've had a lot of clients that have felt guilty for some reason or another about the way their parents passed, including myself. Or, and that keeps them away from actually talking to them because they're afraid, which makes their subconscious, it blocks them. And so it's doubly disruptive if you're constantly serious, because then they don't allow room for, commentation or like for them to come in when it's happy. And I'm especially at fault for that, because every time my parents come in, I'm like, I go to all the checks, like, okay, who's in trouble? Or what brother and sister? I have seven, six other brothers and sisters. What do I have to do? Or what's,
Right. Why am I seeing my parents unless they're trying to warn me about something?
Right. And that's not the case.
Well, I think I was particularly lucky because my parents were hilarious. They were very funny. And so when people say, "Oh, I had a dream about your parents last night," or something, it's always lighthearted. It's always entertaining. It's my mom playing the piano. People are telling stories. And so, I don't get a lot of warnings. I get more like comedy, like lighten up.
Well, they say they use me for that.
For the warnings, that's right. No, and because when people find you, let's say they get to a point where they're like, "I must know the answer," and they're so serious about it, because of course it's stressful to think that you could talk to somebody off stage, but then you find somebody who can talk to them, and you're like, "I have so many questions, and what should I ask?" And sometimes the answer is, "Well, lighten up, remind some joke, something that happened, something that was funny." Your dad brought this up when he came to tell us that a one way to help with grief is to consider nostalgia, which, because
Right.
it's mostly sad memories, and nostalgia has both sad and happy. So once you start thinking about your loved one on the flip side with nostalgia, remember when Uncle Bob used to do those crazy things, that allows them to sort of, okay, well, there's my signal. Go ahead. What does Lou want to tell us today?
I want everybody to know that even though it feels very intense right now for a lot of places around the world, it's still very loving energy that we're sending you during this difficult time. And a way to connect to that energy is by opening up your heart, like with what you remember how we have said, the 1, 2, 3. And I'm ever since you said, your heart is a cell phone, it's pretty amazing, right? That it's true. Like everything that that I studied last weekend, it's all about getting into your heart. And what I've realized with my own work, by doing meditation for myself, I've been able to open up my heart more, and my work has been better, in my opinion. Yeah, I used to think that I couldn't do that because of the challenging content that comes through.
Sure.
Sometimes when parents are in front of me and they no longer have their children, or a kid has cancer, or every day I wake up with stuff like that. But I've realized that I can still open up my heart and not take it all on either.
Well,
And
that's an interesting way to put it. Yeah, open up your heart, but not take it on.
not take it on. And I think that's what they're trying to get through to us, that we don't have there's so many empaths in the world that are feeling depression when it's not theirs. And I know we've discussed that too.
Yeah.
It's
Like,
what
don't you don't have to own that stressful thought. You can say,
No.
well, this is what I'm getting, and this is what I'm going to pass along to you. And, you know, take it for what you can learn from it. Is that something you can access?
The other thing that was interesting too, as I've learned to say, is that everything always works out. It just does. It always works out. So no matter what we stress over, I'm not saying don't live in reality, and that's coming from me, by the way. Be aware of what needs to be done and what makes you feel better. I know when my house is clean, I feel better. I know when I go work out, I feel better. I mean, there's things that you do that you
Right,
feel
things that you can do. Well, now listen, Luana's brought Amelia Earhart to sit down at our chair. And Amelia, what is that what you wanted to say? Just that one thing? You wonder, were you finishing up from last week, or what is it you want to impart to us or talk about?
Oh, and hot lips again. That's so funny.
And Sally Kellerman. All right, very good.
Well,
They weren't finished.
don't ever think, including me, that you know what's going. This is from Amelia. Don't ever think that you know what's going on in somebody else's life, like unless you've walked in their shoes, and a lot of people have not, because they can look like everything's going okay, but they can be in deep, deep pain inside. Be kind to the people that you meet, even the people that you don't know. Thank you. And especially learn to be kind to yourself. I learned that this weekend. You know, I always think that I'm okay, but I was a mean girl to myself over stupid things, an absolute mean girl that would never be like that to anybody else.
Really?
Yeah, just nitpicking over the little things, just so, but your body feels it. Your body go like it's so much easier just to say, wow, look at what you've done, or wow, look at how hard you've worked. I mean, I've never worked this hard before, and I love it. I'm grateful that I get to do this, right?
Yeah.
And the people that I get to meet and the places I get to go. But I can sit there and nitpick about every little stupid thing in the world if I wanted to. And so what she's thinking, so what she's saying is focus on your strengths, whatever they may be. And a lot of people, right, they're feeling lost. They have this sense of loss right now, but that's that sense. Go back to getting back into your heart if you're not in your heart space.
So that, of course, brings up the topic of getting lost. And, you know, most people on the planet think that Amelia got lost. And if you could just talk about that, Amelia, were you ever lost at any point?
She was lost before she got lost, she said. But she talked about the gala. She never, yeah.
What do you mean by that? Do you mean by your life was out of your hands and other people were controlling it?
She said in her relationships, yes.
In her relationship. So, but the idea of being lost, I mean, that's the story that people hear about you. But of course, you were existing continually up until 19. And I want to say, do you want to give me a date? I think it was 1944. Is that correct? Because I have talked to people who claim that they saw you in 1944. So.
She was sick in 1942, it felt like.
Okay.
I
Yeah.
don't know. So let me just give you what
No,
I'm.
that's fine. That's fine. They didn't find her body until 1944 and found the plane in 1944. But there were a couple of Saipanese men that I interviewed who recalled the spring of 44 when she was paraded around on a truck along with two other American pilots that had been shot down who were doing reconnaissance on Saipan. And they saw her then. So that they could be mistaken, but the two of them recalled the same street, the same truck, the same, you know, different parts of it the same day, seeing her. Now, is that accurate? Those two pilots, were they with you?
One, yes, but she said one died immediately, so I don't know if they
They executed both of them eventually. Yeah.
that's, but so this brings me to like something about she's mentioning November, so I know you're talking about the spring, but
Oh, yeah, I think it was July of 1944 when the Erskine neighbors, the guy I interviewed, who was a U.S. Marine who decoded the message that said we found her plane. So they found your plane in July of 44. So it might have been November of, I don't know, whatever, November of 43 when they when you pass away. That's a possibility. But I mean, you know, those kind of dates are always a little problematic.
I don't know. She keeps bringing up 1945 too.
1945. Okay, well, let's not judge it. 1945 is when they found your body. Just they found an arm. That's when they dug up your body, because that's when the GIs were on Saipan and they said, you know, Hansen and Burke, these two GIs, it's in the book by Fred Gerner.
Feels like February of 1945.
Okay. And that's when they dug up your, okay. And so.
Or when she, I don't know, when she passed. I don't know.
Oh, okay. Well, that would be problematic. I'm sorry to hear that, because that means, because they were there, you know, from 44 to 45. But anyway, all I can say is, now let me get this straight. And for the audience tuning in, whether they believe this question is accurate or not is beyond me. But is it true that Catholic nuns moved your body? Or who was it who moved your body from? Yes, correct. All right, that you're nodding. So Catholic nuns moved your body to a more appropriate tomb, a more appropriate burial site. Is that correct?
The same one that they showed me again.
Just all right. And so Jennifer and I know what she's talking about. This is very strange because, of course, you know, anybody who goes to Saipan could find this location. And Jennifer, who's never been to Saipan, drew it for me on a map and said, this is where she is. And I had just come from there. So let's allow that that's what we're getting from Amelia. But what do you want to tell people aside from this whole thing that they get caught up in about your body and your plane and all that stuff? What is it? Because you lived a life in shackles in a way, because you had to keep so many secrets. You're nodding. But also, how should people live a more authentic life? Let's ask you that.
Yeah, she's just saying again, because I wasn't shot, I died from being sick. So she's just reiterating that again.
But she died from dysentery, yeah. That's yeah. What she told us before.
Okay, I'm sorry, what was your question?
My question was, what's some advice for the people tuning in to live a more authentic life? Because your life, from what I understand, was secrets, a lot of secrets that you had to keep.
Don't do anything that you can't do out in front of people. Like as far as not, just like not certain things within reason, please. But if you have a relationship, the way that you can, your soul hurts when you can't express that relationship or when you're not able to be out, like you're not able to live, you can't live fully involved with someone. And that's what she's talking about. So if you're with someone and it's secret, it's secretive, your body holds on to that. Like there's something that happens to your body.
Yes. And for those tuning in for the first or the last time, what she's referring to is that she had a girlfriend for a long time who was a painter. Jennifer's tapping her nose again. And we've talked to her about this and about this painter and who was, let's call her the love of her life for now, just for the purpose of understanding what she's referring to, which is that she had to live a closeted life. And even her husband was aware of it. So, you know, apparently the three of them frolicked. Is that true?
I mean, well, I think she's saying that she did that just because, well, hold on. Say that again. She wasn't sure at first. So that originally was okay in her mind. The three of them, but then she just fell.
Oh, I see. So that, because I had a journalist who walked in on a journalist who interviewed George Putnam's wife, Dorothy, who walked in on the three of them in bed together. And he never put it in his book. And he said, because I thought that was like a weird thing to report. I was like, I think that's the key to the story. Anyway, but you know, here we are talking about something that happened a long time ago. But, you know, suffice to say, the idea of telling people to live a more authentic life.
Says stay grounded, but fly high.
Stay grounded, but fly high. That's a very alliterative and lovely sentiment.
I know.
Very good. And what's your observation about our class, what we're doing here, talking to people on the flip side?
It's complicated. Hold on. She says it serves us as well as it does you,
How
because
so?
she showed me Michael Newton, right?
Yeah, Mike
Or,
Morton.
sorry.
Right, Michael Newton. Go ahead, because that helped people on the planet to access, to realize that they could access people off the planet. And you're saying conversely, it works the other way as well. Or because Michael's been helping people.
Sure. They must be, it's like getting brain scans done. They're electricity-wise, they're figuring out how they can be more effective with the people down here without scaring them too much. Like I see full apparitions of people in the
Yeah,
room.
no, exactly.
That's not everybody can see. Like it used to scare me really, really, really bad. And then I ended up like I have to sleep with the night like a kid. Poor Freddie.
Well, we have to patent
I
you.
showed you that. Were you able to watch the video of all those orbs?
Yeah, that was great. So Jennifer sent me a video of all these orbs in a room. I mean, they were just flying by. It was pretty
I
wild.
was doing meditation and I was wanting to show Freddie. I'm like, look it, I'm in my room. We're gonna do a meditation. Everybody does a meditation like at 10 p.m. And all of a sudden I look at my phone. I didn't see them in front of me, but I looked at my phone like, what is going on here?
That's
As I'm
funny.
looking at my phone. Yeah.
By the way, a couple of weeks ago on our podcast, I saw one fly around your chair and move in a way, like not a way a reflection would move, but it was a circle and went around your chair. Anyway, so it is unusual. It's hard to pin down. We've heard so many different things that the orbs are reflections. They're not literally people, but reflections of energy or people or whatever, consciousness.
They were going fast, that's
They
for
were
sure.
flying around. That's pretty trippy. So Luana,
Give me 1 second.
go ahead.
I want to play it without the.
Oh, okay, please do. Yeah, show it to the audience.
Okay. So
So that ceiling, what is that ceiling? Is that
it's something that I use for hold on. Let me.
right, and they start a little bit in. So like maybe a few seconds in, they just start flying by.
Right. You can see it. Hold on.
We're so funny, people driving in their car.
There you
What?
go.
Oh,
Hold
there
on.
goes one.
There goes one. There goes, you see
There goes
it?
another one. Yeah, that exactly just flew
There
by.
goes, watch. It's so cool. Oh, there goes
Oh,
another
there, yeah,
one.
I'm zipping around.
Look at that. Look at
Oh my
that.
gosh. Yeah, there goes another one. That's very good.
And
Yeah.
there goes, it'll keep going too, but it's crazy.
Well, it reminds me of the woman that you spoke to, and her husband had come and done.
Right. And I've captured them
Oh,
on
yeah,
film.
I
Did you see
noticed.
that other one that was going there? And they'll zip by my head.
Yeah. It's interesting. I mean, oh, there goes another one. Hey, and another one. I see. Yes, you got quite a few. It's funny. I mean, it's just that we can't see them, but the camera can. So, there's another one. So you wonder, like, well, who are these folks? Are they fo Oh, there goes one right into camera. Are these folks that are supposed to are trying to communicate with you?
Isn't
What do
that
you think?
crazy?
What
I
is
felt like it was my mom and dad because I asked my mom and dad and my ancestors to be with me.
Very
And
cool.
so in my mind, that just made me feel better. See that? I mean, it just goes right by my head.
That's amazing. Well, and I'll put a link in the podcast notes today of that thing that I put together of all the stuff outside Michelle's house. I think her name is Michelle. The woman whose husband Dwayne had passed away. And
Right.
so many, and then I gathered them from all over the country, different people with strings of lights sort of flying by and dancing by.
That was the most I've ever seen. And then when I tried to do it again, it happened. I had one other video, but then when I tried to do it again, nothing. I got nothing.
Oh, okay. So
So,
that's good. Good. It's good when you have like a baseline, like here's
yeah,
nothing and then here's something.
I'm like, either they figured it out and got out of there, or I don't know.
Well, it's interesting because when you watch an orb flying around, it doesn't follow any sort of known laws, or you try to think of intent, like why go this way and then that way. It's almost like It's almost like, because there, maybe it's more like being in water. You know how when you have a, like you throw
Right.
something in the water and how it kind of moves in this really unusual way. So, you know, maybe it's the atmosphere of wherever that orb is just a different,
Yeah.
it's
I
easier
don't
for
know.
me to
Well,
say.
I guess we can ask, right? Why
Yeah,
don't
that's
we
right. We
ask?
can ask.
Come
Yeah,
on.
let's ask. Who are those orbs? Who were those folks?
Oh, it was my mom and her parents, my grandparents, the one I was named after. There was more that I didn't know that know you and I.
Oh, okay. Our legions of soldiers following us. Well,
I'm like,
let's ask.
do they do that on purpose? And she's like, Lou's like, yes.
Well, let's ask your mom. Let's ask Linda this question, which is, why do they, you know, why is it for us? Why does it seem they move in a random fashion or like up and down and sideways? There's no logic to it. Why is that?
She's like, because I'm new.
I love your mom. Okay. Well, they all, they not, nobody kind of,
Learning.
that's great.
That is so funny.
Because I'm new.
Because I'm new.
I heard this today on Quora. Somebody wrote me a note and said that she's
Oh,
good.
they're reminding me about this, and that's why I'm showing this, is
Go ahead.
because I did not have proof of what I was seeing. And it took actually watching. I watched Lisa Williams had a show called Among the Dead or something. This was about, I don't know, 15 years ago. And she had one episode where they felt like the bar that I don't know, there was shoes. Anyways, she had like night vision. She was able to see these orbs going back and forth. And that was the first time that I saw someone. I'm like, okay, it made so much sense to me that it wasn't just in my mind, that it really was, there was some tangibility to it. Like
Yeah.
it helped me. And so for some reason, they wanted that to happen so we could show it, of course, and then it could help maybe somebody else know. Like they have to do their own investigations about it, but it'll take you down a rabbit hole if you start,
Yeah, that's right. If
looking up
you
what
just
for.
type in, you know, orbs, ring cameras, and then just watch their, you know, shops and stores all over the country, all over the world. And where people capture these, sometimes there's strings of lights, like four or five at a time. And then I noticed that if you turn them on their side, they look like musical scores, you know, like because the notes are differently spaced, they're not even,
Beethoven,
you
yeah.
know, yeah, like Beethoven, dun 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 dun, and, you know, and they're moving around, and you're thinking, why a string of lights? You know, are they echoes of frequency? I don't know, but I mean, it's fascinating to examine, to think about, to consider, and to ask your mom. Which her answer is hilarious.
Oh, I asked her, I'm like, so did you like it? She goes, you saw how fast I was going. Like, boom, boom.
So there's an, is it entertaining, Linda, to do that? Is it fun to do that? Or is it just kind of like you're keeping an eye on Jennifer?
You're just keeping an eye on me. But I did. She goes, you did ask us to be with you. There is no time over there. So I wasn't like, oh, you're going to bed. I mean, I have the universe up.
Sure, yeah, they're all standing by.
That's the only way I can go to sleep at hotel rooms too. Because this is a really important thing. I would highly recommend this for parents who have children that are afraid of at night. Get those lights. Like get a light that, they're very inexpensive. You can now get them. You can look on Amazon and they give you the universe. And then that way it's not dark. Because if you put like a light away or a light that's outside versus up here, you could see dark shadows come in.
Oh,
And
wow.
that's how people get scared. I used to get scared as a little kid. And so if it's on the ceiling, I notice that I can't see them as much. But if I don't have it, I see everything and it's very thick.
Okay.
It's,
Well, that's,
yeah.
I mean, and of course, we've talked about this, the filters on the brain. Some children don't have those filters until they're about 8. And so, you know, they may see things and
Right. It just
observe.
helps. I
This
mean,
helps, yeah. I mean, nightlight. I listen. I had the experience. I was teaching in Maine at this film school in Camden,
wow.
Maine, back in the
I love
19.
Camden.
Oh yeah, beautiful.
Yeah, it's
The workshops in Maine.
beautiful.
And the first night I was there, I woke up and there was a Mohawk Indian,
Right,
Algonquin,
I remember that.
like
Yeah.
leaning over me with an axe and a knife, and they were dripping blood, and he was screaming. I mean, it woke me up. He was screaming something in Algonquin, I think. I don't know. But the impression was like, get out. I thought, you know, and then I woke up and he disappeared. And so, of course, I turned every light in the place on. I turned every radio on because I figured if the frequency is disrupted, he didn't bother me again. But I mean, everything. I had the kitchen door open, you know, the whatever, the fridge door, because there was a light in there too. Anything to disrupt this guy.
And for people that are listening to this, go, when you do have time, go to YouTube and watch the video that I just put up there.
Okay, cool. Yeah. And where would they find that? Under Jennifer Shaffer? Or?
Oh, on yours.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, on us. They'll find that. That's right. No, and there's also the Michelle thing, which I, you know, I'll put a link.
I sent it to you, so you should, you know, do it without the noise.
Yeah, it's without the noise. Dulcet tones. Yeah. Wow, that's pretty trippy. Amelia, anything else you want to say? I don't want to leave you hanging on the chair there. I know you're always welcome to come by and talk to us.
Hold on. Do more. Oh, okay. Thank you. Do more things to get you out of your comfort zone. And so she was saying, like, a lot of times, you know, a lot of people stay home. They're just, whether they're used to it from COVID or whatever, it's more challenging to get out and go out. But it's harder for them to, because if we're watching TV or if we're watching something or listening to something, or mentioning me, it's more challenging for them to come in and give you things that, you know,
to do or things to observe. Okay. So if you're out in the world, they can put your attention towards a song or some place they like to go to.
Right. Right. It gives us more opportunities to converse with you by going out in nature. You know, we're able to show you butterflies or birds or whatever it is, or tarantulas. I just saw that.
Tarantulas. Okay. Well, you know, well, scorpions probably, because Amelia did spend time out in the desert. But I would say this, I have talked about it before. You ask them, when you're asking them questions like, how are you? Who greeted you when you crossed over? Those simple things. Ask them, where's a great place for us to communicate better? And they'll show you. It might even be their favorite restaurant, you know, they'd like to go to, and you could be sitting there asking them questions, but like a forest or like the woods or a garden or the beach, you know, or a park bench somewhere, and they'll pop it in your mind. And it's just, you continue the conversation. You could ask the same questions, you get new ones.
And Amelia did say that she's given you more things to write about recently.
Yeah. Okay. She has. You know what? I started writing. I just thought to myself, I'm going to picture myself in the moment of whatever this event was, whatever it is, fill in the blank. And when you do that, you're like, okay, I'm going to put my feet in the shoes of this person. You start seeing things and hearing things that make sense. Like, oh, okay. That makes sense. That probably is the way it happened.
That's interesting, because she told me, you know, you never know about the other person's shoes, right? Yeah. Walking shoes. We said this earlier today. So that was interesting that you're mentioning.
Well, but I think that's the thing, which is, and it's true in life, if you can just put yourself in the shoes of somebody that you're mad at or upset with, you really can say, oh, okay, I see. They're abused. They feel abused. They were hurt. Something happened to them. So, it's a chain. I can either allow that this annoys me, that they're annoying to me, or I can say, you know what? I wish them the best. Something like that. Yeah. Right. Anyway, that's interesting she'd say that, because I was kind of honing in on that. So you encourage that, Amelia? Is that what you're telling me? Keep that up?
Absolutely. Yeah. All right. You get a lot of things at coffee shops, so don't be afraid to come.
I get a lot of coffee. See, my hair was black when I met you. And then it was like, coffee, 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 coffee. I don't have you much longer, do I? Any last words, Luana?
She's saying to have you say it, that she'll put the words in your mind.
What do you mean? I don't understand.
Like how I get information. I don't know. They're just saying that they'll put it through you. Like, does she have, so ask her, do what I do.
Hey, Lou, what do you, your last words that come to mind? Be your authentic self. And your authentic self should love yourself first. And then if you can love yourself, then you can love other people, because opening your heart to everyone and all things is a way for you to have that oceanic experience or the epiphany that makes us want to return to the planet over and over again.
Yeah.
Something like that, Lou? Is that what you were thinking?
What I was receiving was the thing that I worked on a lot too, was loving myself, because I'm very critical of myself. And I didn't realize that I really have not had that, you know, I'm constantly trying to help other people, but for myself, I'm like, I'm okay, I'm fine kind of thing. And to really love yourself, it definitely does something for your body. It does something for your mind. It does something for your day. So meditation is so great to do in the morning if you have a chance to do it in the morning, because you can tell yourself you're a badass. You got this. It's going to be okay. Whatever it is, you know, however it is, you don't have to say that, but just.
No, I like it. I like it. That's great. Of course, that is the thing. You know, it's that old thing of looking in the mirror and go, let's go get this.
Let's go.
Yeah. And what we started with was nobody gets to the flip side wishing they had done less.
Right. And we're doing a lot less apparently, and staying home and not going, like,
yeah,
you can still, there's so many things that are for free. Like go to the ocean, go hug a tree, go whatever it is, go to a garden, or, you know, go have tea with somebody. Like, it's not things that are expensive. Love is free. You can, you know, figure out what makes you happy, but they're able to, what they're telling, you know, and it makes sense. They're able to do so much more. Like, if I didn't go to this thing this weekend, I wouldn't have saw those orbs. I mean, I've been living.
That's right. You wouldn't have seen that.
Years and years and years, but now my mom's new. I'll put it on my Instagram page too.
Okay. That's very cool. Well, thank you, Amelia, for stopping by to say hi to us. I really appreciate it. You know, and when you think about her journey, where she spent at least 10 years on the front page of every newspaper, or a newspaper somewhere in the world, and then she had to go, you know, in this weird thing of being captured. And even then, there's moments of joy, whether it's the summer rain, or whether it's the sound of crickets, or whether it's a rooster crowing in the background. So you got to look for the joy, no matter how weird your journey seems to be. That's my thought for the day.
And if you fall, just get back up. Get back up.
Get back up and get at it. Okay.
Hi, Dan.
All right. Very good. All right. Thank you, Jennifer. Thank you, Amelia. Thank you, Luana. And anybody else? Oh, thank you, Linda, for stopping by. That was very cool. Hilarious.
Fun. That's fun.
We love you. Thank you.
Bye.
This has been Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Shaffer. For more information, jennifershaffer.com, martinizone.com, or richmartini.com. Hacking the Afterlife documentary is available on Amazon Prime.